you a little bit more about this year's, about the Les Paul Award in general, let me introduce Les Paul's son, Russ, representing the Les Paul Foundation. Russ Paul.
Boy, I'll tell you what, I wish Dad was here right now. I mean, it's been 2.5 years, and I miss that guy so much. And I'm sure he's touched a lot of people right here, right now. I want to thank you very, very much, because he had a great respect for this NAMM show and audio. As you know, his nickname was Hum Hiss Paul. So he wanted to get rid of all those problems, but he sure brought a lot of new ones in. But we're going to conquer them someday. Someday we'll get there. Steve's Vi has been a close friend for a long time, and he's been a terrific guitar player. He's done a lot. He's accomplished a lot. He's going to do a lot more. I ran into him today. He was down there signing, and I come over in front of it and stood there waiting for him, and he looked up. He says, "Oh, you're going to sit at my table tonight, aren't you?" And I says, "Yeah." But it's such a great pleasure to be here, and so many of the people out there, Dad has touched you, I'm sure. And it's meant so much to him in the industry, with so many people out there like Manley and everybody else, Putnam and all these guys at Pro Tools, and they're all out there. They're all friends of Dad's very much. And he would like to see it today, I'm sure, what it accomplished. And being that he made the 8-track, the first 8-track, made it very convenient for things to happen after that, you know. But it took him a long time to figure that out. Also, I want to thank the Helena Reznor and the NAMM show and the Les Paul Foundation. I think the Les Paul Foundation is doing a fabulous job, and it's going to do a bigger one in the future. But we like to have everybody involved in it if they wish. It would be a very important thing. We don't want to lose the memory of a man that did so much for the industry. Thank you.
To tell you guys a little bit more about this year's Les Paul Award winner, Steve Vi, please welcome the incredibly accomplished bass player, good friend of mine, Billy Sheehan.
Hello, everyone. I didn't get a chance to teleprompterize this, so I'm going to just read it off the sheet. I hope you don't mind. What an incredible thing to be, all of us here tonight, for the most part, of the same mind. To be a musician, or to be in any way connected to performance, recording, equipping, supplying, supporting, in so many ways, the expression of this glorious endeavor is to be, in my humble opinion, elevated above being merely human. We are here today to give a special recognition to someone who has surpassed expectations at all levels, who has gone above and beyond anything ever required or demanded of him as a matter of course, who has been a source of inspiration for everyone who not only worked with or heard him play, but who has heard of him. This, of course, is our friend, Steve Vi. I know a lot of people in the music biz, some of my favorite people, supreme talents, all in it for the love of this wonderful art we share in common. Standing out amongst them in so many ways, Steve has worked as hard as anyone, harder than most, to bring dreams to reality. While doing so, along the way, he has been an incredible help to his fellow musicians. In this world, there are givers and takers. Steve has been such a giver in abundance to so many along the way that it would take way too much time to begin listing them here tonight. His tireless quest for perfection, always tempered with a sense of humor and self-deprecation, never asking anything of anyone he would not or could not do himself, yet pushing others to peak of their capabilities. Around him, people reach heights they never knew they could, inspired by his urging and example. All true. Tonight we give an award to a real artist who has overpaid his dues, who has stayed true to his artistic ideals and refused to compromise, who has blazed a trail that many can now follow. Music is the greatest art form. That is no self-aggrandizement. Philosophers through the years have proven it out time and time again. A true musician, a dear friend to so many, a wonderful father and husband, and one of the best damn guitar players this planet will ever see or hear. We present this award as a comparatively small acknowledgement to all that he has accomplished. It is with great honor and gratitude that I have the privilege, along with Russ, of presenting this to you tonight, Steve. I know of no one who deserves it more. Please join me in a round of applause as a token of our love and respect to our dear friend, Steve Vai.
Wow, my brother here, Billy, thank you so much. I've had the great privilege of touring with this man, and he is the greatest man in the world to tour with, the funniest guy I know, and one of the most talented. Thank you, Bill.
I love you, Steve. Thank
yeah, man. Well, if I was half as good as that video made me out to be, I might actually deserve this award. But, you know, when I got the call for this, I immediately thought, oh my gosh, I have this project I gotta do in Holland, you know? And I thought, well, I gotta make a choice here, being, honored by my esteemed colleagues or dope and porn, you know? it was kinda, but Amsterdam can wait, right? Actually, I want to congratulate the TEC Awards on what a great achievement. What was it? This is the 27 years. That's amazing. And it cultivates the awareness of technology, which, you know, in this business, there's two things that we really need. One is the artist to make the music, and two are the people that know how to capture it and make it real in the world. And it's beautiful. And I want to thank the awards for making this such an amazing tribute to Les. I mean, this man, you know, most of you know what his accomplishments have been. I mean, if it wasn't for Les, we'd probably all be playing acoustic guitars, you know, in mono. And, I mean, there was a guy that just pushed and pushed, and he loved what he did. He was so passionate. I mean, this guy was playing the guitar, and I mean really playing the guitar, when he was 90 years old and older. 94 and a half. I mean, and I've actually had the great privilege of performing a couple of times with him. And I remember I walked out on stage and I had my, you know, weird, kind of very different guitar. It had like a whammy bar that was kind of crazy. And I had this big cutaway and 24 frets. And he looks at me and goes, "What's that, son?" And I said, "Get yourself a real guitar."
Okay.
He actually signed my guitar, and it was wonderful because it's probably one of the most cherished things he wrote. Great player. To Steve, a great player. Les. So that's a real treasure for me. Yeah. And wow, I mean, when I looked at this award, I mean, the past nominees, every single one of them have had such a wonderful quality of life effect on me and most of us, that when I look at that list, and I never in my wildest dreams would I have even thought that my name would be mentioned in the same paragraph as these guys, and especially Les Paul. So I'm kind of stunned, and thank you so much again to the TEC Awards for recognizing this and for considering me for this award. It's so wonderful. And I need to, thanks. Oh my gosh, I only got past the first two paragraphs. My thanks go out to everybody, especially my manager of 21 years, Ruta Cepedes, and my wife, who I've been with for 32 years, Pia. And I love these long, I've had such a charmed life, I gotta say. You know, I have to say, I don't feel like I've ever struggled a day in my life in this business. And I'll tell you why, because for me, it was always about the excitement and the passion was about picking up the guitar and not being able to do something and then working on it and then being able to do it. You know, that was the juice, you know, that was always the thing, and that was the thing that just kept pushing me on, and that was my passion. Besides money and sex. I know what you like. But anyway, just kidding, sort of. But really, that's the thing that I really focused on, because it brought me joy. Just like everybody that's being presented here tonight, you don't make accomplishments like all of you guys in here unless you're really following something that you love and that you're passionate about, because you have no choice, and you almost have to be obsessed with it. And everything else comes. You know, I was an 18-year-old kid, and I was working with Frank Zappa. How does that happen, you know? And it just happened. It was handed to me, really. And I was capable of doing something that was exciting to me. And working with Frank, talk about a techie. This guy, Frank would take any piece of gear that you can imagine and squeeze it and churn it and pull it. It was like a pit bull with a steak, you know? And he would find everything that you, I mean, you know, when you get a piece of gear, you plug it in, you go, okay, what does this do? Okay, oh, here's a preset. Frank was nothing like that. He dug really deep into every parameter, and when he squeezed it as hard as he could, he'd call the company and tell them what they need to do to make it better. Honest, remember the synclavier, you know, and the work he did with that? Well, when I was growing up, and I was 18, 19, and I joined his band when I was 20, this is what I saw. And when you're that young and impressionable, you think, well, that's the way you're supposed to do it. You know, you just got to do it this way. I remember the first time I was in the studio, and he mixed one part of a song, he mixed another part of the song, and it was two-track tape, and the tape is going over the head, and he stops the tape, and he puts a little mark on it, and I'm thinking, what is he doing, you know? And he takes the tape off, and he puts it on the edit block, and he cuts it. I'm like, geez, he's cutting the tape, you know? And then he goes to another piece of tape and he cuts it. I'm thinking, what is he doing? Then he puts the little piece of, you know, tape on it and he plays it back. And it was the first time I had an epiphany. I realized when the tape went, you know, the tape went over the head, I realized this is editing. And the whole world opened up to me, the tech world. And I looked at Frank and I said, oh, that's amazing. And in true Frank form, he just said, yeah, it makes every day like Christmas. Yeah, it was great. And really, I've just been so lucky. Like I say, one thing after another just happened. Billy got me into the Dave Roth band. And boy, oh boy, do you remember the 80s?
Kind of.
I don't. And then I've just had, you know, one great gig after another. And I've just been so blessed to be able to be a part of this tech industry because I get to work with such great guys. I've been able to forge long-lasting, great relationships. I mean, you know, Larry DiMarzio is sitting over there. Larry DiMarzio, I used to drool over his pickups when I was, a teenager. And then next thing you know, I'm with him and I'm talking to him. This is 1985 and he's making pickups for me. And we've had a great relationship ever since, and we've made pickups that have been, you know, purchasable, and, you know, guys like Ernie Ball with the strings, and Morley, and Carvin. I mean, I've had a really long relationship with Carvin. It goes back to when I was, well, first, I remember I was about 14 years old, and I'd get the Carvin catalog, and it had, like, you know, big mountains of speakers and stuff out on a front lawn, and it was like porn. Oh, my God, you know? I couldn't wait to get to the next page because I knew it might be better than the previous page. Yeah. And before I knew it, I moved out to California, and Frank was working with Carvin. So in 1980, I forged a relationship with them, and it's just been wonderful. It's been, you know, decades. And this NAMM show have come out with a new amplifier. And it's just so nice to have people do whatever you want. And then, of course, there was Ibanez, who, you know, when I was starting to get some notoriety, I had some peculiar ideas that I wanted in a guitar, and there was a lot of manufacturers that were interested in making a guitar like that at the time. But Ibanez, you know, they said, we'll make you anything you want. And I said, well, I want a guitar that has a cutaway like this, and then, you know, 24 frets and a whammy bar that you can pull up on until the string breaks and, you know, all this stuff. And they said, okay, how many? You know? So, I mean, And then I'd really test them. I'd say, okay, I want you to make me a guitar with three necks. And I want two necks to come out on this side. I want one of them to be fretless, the other one to be a 12 string, and then a normal neck. Oh, and by the way, make it shaped like a giant heart. They said, yes, Mr. Steve, we'll make you two, a purple one and a red one, and they did. So I've been really blessed to be able to work with these great companies all along. And you know, it's interesting with tech, the way that we make music, the way that we create it, the way that we package it, the way that we sell it, and the way that we listen to it is constantly changing. And it has constantly changed, and it will constantly change. And that's how we are. You know, we're always looking to progress. I mean, just think about last year and just the amount of developments that have been happening just in the past year. It's a wonderful thing, and this is such a creative business, and I really feel we're blessed to be a part of it. And we encourage each other with our inventions, you know? We all want to know what the other guy's doing, you know? And it encourages us and inspires us, and that's one of the ways that we work together. And really, the limitation is our imagination. And I'd like to, you know, I'd like to just give you a couple of quotes here from people that have inspired me through the years, because I think these quotes are, you know, much cooler than I am. I mean, Albert Einstein and Thomas Edison said, thoughts are things. Thoughts are actually things. They're measurable. They change the molecular structure of things. And when we think, we send out thoughts, and they're like a frequency. And what we get back is like-minded things that we're thinking. And that's how all of us create all of this gear. It's how we create our poetry. It's how we do, and we all do it, you know? Even the Kardashians. You know? They do. And there's another great quote, Napoleon Hill. You're going to love this one. Anything that the mind of man can conceive of and bring himself to believe is true, he can create. And that's a brilliant quote if you think about it. It shows you, it resonates with Einstein and Edison and everything that we do. And then my favorite artist, Tom Waits, is absolutely my favorite artist. He said something really great that I think about all the time. He said, you gotta find what you're really good at and then exaggerate it. Isn't that great? And I would be remiss if I didn't give you a Frank quote. Now, this is a quote that I have on a little piece of paper on my computer that I read every single day, all day. And Frank said a lot of great things. I mean, he was just so amazing. I still can't believe I had the great privilege of 6 years with Frank Zappa. I mean, he said a lot of, and he would say it right like that, and that was it. You know, he didn't mince words or anything. And you better be careful when you talk to him, if you be prepared to hear the truth. Well, I'll tell you one quick funny story. He went into this radio show. This guy's name was Joe Pine, and he had this radio show. It was a television show, nationwide. He was kind of a wise guy, and the guy sported a wooden leg, right? So he was always trying to, you know, get the better of people who came on the show, and Frank came on the show, and he had all the long hair and everything, and he sits down, and the first thing that this guy, Joe Pine, says to Frank is, huh, with all that hair, that must make you a woman. And without missing a beat, Frank said, with that wooden leg, that must make you a table. But that all the time, every day, we would just say stuff and wait to see what Frank would say, because it was a gem, you know? But there was one thing he said, and it really rings true. When he was asked by a young, you know, musician, I think it was a young musician, they said, what kind of advice would you give a young musician? I asked him that advice, and he said, keep your publishing. But actually, in this particular instance, he said, there's only two things to remember. Number one, don't stop, and number two, keep going. Okay, thank you. So, I think I can speak on behalf of most of you here when I say that to be recognized for your contribution is really touching. And it's inspirational. It's probably one of the most inspirational things that we can experience, because when we feel like what we're doing is valuable to somebody, it inspires us to continue. And so I guess what I'm saying is thank you, because this is probably the most inspirational moment of my life.